I suppose I wonder, where do you stop being you as an individual and where do you become simply a member of your species? For example, say you're at a football or baseball game and a flock of birds flies over the stadium and the crowd looks up at the flock of birds and says, oh, it's just a flock of birds. And then the birds look down at the people and say, oh, it's just a flock of people. Well, what makes any one individual person different from any other individual? The list of things really isn't very long when you think about it. Religion, family, history, geography, politics, all the things that used to count don't exist anymore, or else they've mutated. Identity's become an entirely fluid issue now.
Douglas Coupland, let's start at the beginning. When's your birthday? When and where did you begin?
I began on December 30th, 1961, on a Canadian NATO base in West Germany.
Do you consider yourself a citizen of the late 20th century?
Yes.
Douglas, let's talk about people, specifically the types of people our culture is creating at this point in history. Our minds, our bodies, our souls. Let's discuss the idea of not having a life, of being biologically alive, but not having a life.
Well, what is a life? Suddenly it's become this burning question. I mean, it's not something that anyone ever expected to have to ask. Suddenly we have to articulate what life is, and it's almost absurd, yet necessary at the same time. Suddenly in the last 10 to 15 years, people have just stopped having lives. People who used to have lives now don't.
Cut.
But if you were to travel back in time, even 20 years, and you said to someone, hey, look at Larry, Larry doesn't have a life, that person would give you a blank stare and say, what are you talking about? Of course Larry, he's alive, he's breathing, he's got a pulse, of course he's living, what are you talking about? But now, I mean, not having a life is so common, it's almost become the norm.
But what caused that change? Was it the deluge of information technology that was supposed to liberate us and give us more of a life?
Well, yes, but first you have to get super basic. You have to think about time. You have to consider the way you perceive time's flow. The split between being biologically alive and having a life has to do with the way you perceive time and the way you perceive your information environment. I think people used to think that time was a constant, like gravity or the speed of light, but as it turns out, it's entirely relative. It used to be that if a person was alive for 71.3 years, they got to experience all 71.3 years of life. Now people aren't experiencing their 71.3 years of life anymore, and I think they're maybe freaking out. I wonder if people feel as if they're drowning somehow. We live in a consumer culture. Maybe it's a value for your money thing, but people just aren't getting their years worth of year anymore.
Why not?
We've increased the information density in our culture to the point where our perception of time is now all screwy. Here's a minor example I always use. I might be reading a People magazine article about Bert and Lonnie's breakup, and in the process I'll burn up 1,484,362 brain cells. These are cells that might have been put toward finding a solution for world peace, or maybe just meditating on a twig the way people used to before TV and stuff. But instead, these are cells that got used up wondering about Bert's hair.
But time, you said that technology has, well, mutated time in a way. How?
Well, I think people remember the late 20th century as a place obsessed with efficiency, a place where people cram more and more productivity into fewer time slots, a place where humans invented all these inventions to speed up the flow of information, FedEx, Prozac, microwave ovens, fax machines, but then it all backfired.
Backfired?
Mm-hmm. Technology gives you more time only up until a certain point, and then time starts vanishing at this fantastic rate, like a car running out of gas. I used to have this fantasy that I'd go into a coma for 1 year. When I came out of the coma, I'd have a year's worth of magazines and pop culture to catch up on. It would be like information crack and really fun, but now every day is like waking up after a year of having been in a coma.
Okay, here's a question, Douglas. How is the typical person of today different from the typical person of, say, 200 years ago?
200 years ago, people assumed that life would never change from year to year, the way birds and animals see time as something eternal. Modern people see tomorrow as this place that will be totally and utterly different from today, with new hairdos and clothes and architecture and ideas and weather.
Do you believe in randomness?
No, if something seems random, it means you're standing too close to a very large pattern, and you can't see the pattern because you're too close to it.
Are you middle class?
Yeah.
All right. Name the two dominant activities of life 20 years from now.
Going shopping and going to jail.
Douglas, where does your sense of self come from? Who is the you of you?
You mean where do I locate my sense of being, my sense of who I am now?
Yes.
Okay, well, here's an exercise. Ask yourself, am I trapped being myself forever? Am I ever going to change? Well, what if I took a stick of dynamite and put it inside you and blew you up like a cartoon Sylvester the Cat? You know the shot that comes after where there's like a tail walking around picking up like a leg and like reassembling, Sylvester builds himself back up again? Well, what if you didn't have to be you? What if you could be anyone you wanted to? Would you be young or old or rich or poor or black or white, or where would you live on Earth, or when would you be? Who would you be? How would you reassemble yourself if you didn't have to be you?
Let me ask you then, Douglas, who would most people choose to reassemble themselves as?
Well, I think that most people, after you blew them up with dynamite, would reassemble themselves so that they looked like everyone else around them. That's where I think our specieshood asserts itself, like the birds we were talking about at the beginning. I think this need to resemble everybody else is why we shop at, say, The Gap or at Benetton, so that we can be animals in a way. It's our way of reverting to our specieshood.
Your point being?
Well, you never hear an animal saying, like, hey, I think I'm going to move to San Diego and change the color of my fur and lose 20 pounds and change my identity. I think human beings are the only animal that think they can change who they are simply by moving to a different place. I mean, birds migrate, but it's not quite the same thing.
But you were talking about shopping for identity.
Well, yeah. Part of not having a life means you have a screwed up sense of time, but it also means you have a screwed up sense of place as well.
Place?
Yeah, place ties into shopping and, say, The Gap. I mean, you've got this kid lives in Armpit, Nebraska, and he goes out to the local Gap franchise, and in his head he's got pictures of the Concorde, Manhattan, and Claudia Schiffer, and then, so in his head he's living in Manhattan. Meanwhile, in Manhattan, you've got this other kid who's going to the Gap franchise, and in his head he's got pictures of Armpit, Nebraska. So in both their heads, they're living everywhere and nowhere at the same time.
So in a sense, Douglas, what you're saying is that our sense of ourselves no longer comes from within, but is influenced by all these things outside of us. The Gap, McDonald's, supermodels.
Yeah, I think many people mistake the current deluge of information diversity as being the end of history, but in a way I think it's actually the beginning of history.
Talking about how minds have changed in the late 20th century, what about bodies? How has our relationship with our bodies changed?
Well,
And thinking about last week, I was looking at these photographs from the 1950s, and in them everyone was trying to look exactly 35 years old. I mean, you had these 18-year-old boys and girls and these 58-year-old men and women, and everyone was trying to look 35 years old. So that was the age you were supposed to be inside your head back then, is 35. And now what's happened, I think, is that the mental age everyone's trying to be inside their head is about 24, and that's an 11-year shift.
But what about on a deeper level?
Well, as we're talking about the late 20th century here, I think we're probably going to remember this period of time as being one in which the relationship between the mind and the body was completely severed.
Could you give us an example?
I'm fascinated by people with extreme mind-body relationships, people like bodybuilders or models or anorexics, people for whom the relationship is like the earth and the moon. There is obviously a relationship, but there's never a true connection at any point. I remember I once read about Karen Carpenter, how she felt as though the entire world existed on the other side of 10 feet of plexiglass. And I think in a way that defines the current mind-body relationship.
How does the modern separation occur?
Well, maybe you're abused as a child, or maybe you're simply lonely. The fact is, the separation does occur, and then suddenly you become this thing that is you, but not you at the same time. Years ago, the only people who had mirrors were kings and queens, and people didn't even know what they looked like. And nowadays, gosh, people use their bodies as marketing tools, as resumes. It's a really strange point in history. In a way, people have become their own focus group. I'm just sort of wondering, actually, about our culture's obsession with supermodels and what it means.
What about it?
Well, I wonder if our obsession with supermodels reflects the super separation of the mind and body we now have in the culture.
Okay, some quick questions here. Are you a vegetarian?
I try.
Have you ever done cocaine?
No.
Acid?
No.
Any tattoos or piercings?
Not yet.
Do you go to the gym?
I try.
Have you ever used steroids?
No.
What? What are you thinking about?
Well, it's just that I've always been really skinny, and so 6 years ago I stopped smoking and started going to a Gold's Gym to stop being skinny. And before I began working out, this woman took calipers to my arms and legs and body and measured the ratios of meat to fat to bone to water. And when she was done, she made this horrified facial expression. And I said, well, what's the deal? I mean, and she said, no. And I said, no, tell me. And she said, well, Douglas, you're what's known technically as a thin, fat person. And I was just horrified. I mean, it's the worst thing you can be. It's, you know, you're skinny and what you have isn't even meat.
What?
It's just a thought that came to mind of how when archaeologists of the future dig up the ruins of California, they're going to find all these fitness centers and all these weightlifting equipment devices. And they're just going to assume that we were a culture completely obsessed with torture.
So when people do all of these late 20th century things to their bodies, like mega dieting, plastic surgery, boob jobs, steroids, what is it that they're really looking for?
Well, my guess is that they want to participate in realms in which they're not going to be held responsible for, which is to say, oh, it wasn't me, officer, it was my body that did it. I mean, say you're a guy and you have pectoral muscles like Fabio. I mean, they're like beef throw cushions. You can throw all the responsibility away from yourself and your actions onto the throw cushions. And I suppose it's the same for women, too.
What about disease? It's such a big part of bodies in the late 20th century.
Well, I think what's happened is people have begun viewing their bodies as being fortresses or inviolable, made out of that same sort of hard, shiny plastic as Lego. But the funny thing here is that the average human body contains 10 times as many alien cells as it actually contains cells of itself. So instead of Lego, the average human body is more like Pigpen from Charlie Brown. Remember the way he used to walk down the street in that sort of perpetual haze of dust and germs? Well, you know, that's people. Actually, we're already so ridden with disease and other organisms that the whole notion of being a fortress becomes somewhat beside the point. Actually, now that I think about it, Pigpen is doing TV commercials for vacuum cleaners right now. So I guess he's got a good agent.
So back to the main thread. Where exactly are we now?
Well, minds are separated from the body, and the mind itself is lost in time and space, and so the soul, if you want to call it that, becomes this little twinkle of light hovering outside managing the meat. The mind becomes like a crew chief at Burger King, and one sense of time becomes like the French fry computer beeping, and it doesn't matter where the Burger King is because they're all the same anyway.
So what's a person to do?
Well, you have to figure out a way of getting that little twinkle of light back inside the meat, back inside of time, and back inside of space.
I remember baked chicken Mom used to make. It was so good. She made it with shake and bake. The chicken was sure crispy.
Okay, Douglas, we've talked about the mind and the body. Now let's talk about the human soul. Lately, we seem to be transferring it into and onto machines. It feels like we're creating something really big. Do you think it's possible to create something more complex than the human consciousness?
In fact, I think we've already done that with machines and film, TV, books, and databases. We've reached a critical mass point now where the amount of memory we put out in the world exceeds the amount of memory contained within our collective biological meat bodies. So, in other words, there's now more memory out there than exists inside of all of us. We've actually created this entity that's bigger than us, but at the same time, it is us.
A greater use of closed-circuit TV is certain. As a matter of simple arithmetic, more time plus more money equals more automobiles.
What did we do before we created this thing, the entity?
Well, before the entity, before machines, the only form of entertainment people really had was relationships.
Does that mean we don't have relationships anymore?
No, but it means that the nature of relationships has changed, the nature of being alive has changed, and the nature of, having life has changed too. I mean, machines are obviously a direct part of this change. They're not going to go away. It really amazes me when people talk about this future as though it's a place that doesn't have TV sets in it. Try and make everyone on Earth simultaneously forget the wheel, and it's just not going to happen.
Is too much memory, the entity, is that a bad thing?
No, it's inevitable, so you can't be moralistic about it. You can't yell at the weather and make it go away. It's just too big. Change doesn't bug me. I tend to look at all these new changes the way I used to look at those old holes they used in Warner Brothers cartoons. Remember when Daffy Duck was in a fix, he'd reach into his pocket and pull out a cartoon hole and throw it in the ground and jump into it and escape? Well, I always used to wonder what it was you'd find at the other end of the hole, where it was you'd end up being. I guess I still do. In a way, I think the future is whatever it is and wherever it is that lies on the other side of that cartoon hole.
But all of this memory, there's only going to be more and more accumulation of it. How does a person cope? As you said, every day is like waking up from a year-long coma.
Well, there's obviously no point in trying to remember everything, because then everything just becomes trivia. Cellulose production in Lake Baikal in rush hour, the contents of Tori Spelling's clothes closet, or the weather in Harlingen, Texas. What's important is being able to locate things.
So has bulk memory replaced history?
Yeah, sort of the way bulk shopping has replaced regular shopping. I remember back in the 70s in history class when teachers would say to us very sonorously, "He who does not remember the past is doomed to repeat it." And I just don't think that's the case anymore. I think that what's happened now is that we've created a scenario so radically different that there's no historical precedent to look back on for the situation we now face. We're no longer condemned to repeat an endless cycle of mistakes. I think this should come as a relief, too. I mean, no more dark age followed by golden age followed by another inevitable dark age. I mean, how great to have finally broken the cycle of history, that people can actually manufacture a destiny of their own choosing.
Do you believe in progress?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
If you could be an animal, what animal would you be?
I already am an animal.
So where does personal memory fit into all of this? Doesn't it get swamped by the super memory humans are creating? What about the personal stuff?
No, the personal stuff, personal memory, it's the most important thing of all. It's the one thing that can never be taken away from you. It is you. And despite all the recent changes in our time architecture, it still takes time to create memories. It still takes time to remember them. It takes a place in which to locate the memories and a place in which to be still and remember them. It takes a lot of work to be an individual and to have an individual life. And it can be scary, but then the option is to forget and to be forgotten.
Are those your last words?
No. I'd say, hey, kids, go blow yourself up with dynamite and reassemble your bits any way you want to assemble them. Hey, kids, go and jump into that cartoon hole and find out what lies on the other side. I'd say, you know, all the time in the world, it's right there, it's inside you. I'd say, all the world in the world, it's right there inside you. I mean, maybe you have a life and maybe you don't. I don't know you, but you're not alone. I remember back in the 1970s, about the same time people stopped having lives, they also began making fun of intimacy, and they made jokes about people like Halston having parties at Studio 54 for his 500 close personal friends. And so I guess the whole world's Studio 54 now. It's just you and me, babe, and billions of other people out there just like you, billions of close personal friends.